Title of the talk is Geometric Criteria for Testing the Extremity of Super Modular and XR Games, and it's based on joint research with my colleague in the Institute, Tomáš Kroupa and Vašek Rotochvíl.
Well, doesn't seem to work.
Okay. This is a summary. In the introduction, I will explain the motivation. It's some problems concerning two counts of set functions, which are used widely in game theory. Then I will define the basic concepts and review some analogous concepts in various areas of mathematics, like besides game theory, theory of imprecise probabilities, and combinatorial optimization and game theory. Polyhedral geometry. The criteria I will present are based on certain mean representation of an XR game. I will try to describe the criteria shortly. Yes. The source of motivation for this research lies in game theory. Specifically, in a subspace which is called transferable utility collision games. There are two important classes of set functions studied in this area. That's a class of supermodular games, traditionally called convex games in game theory, and class of so-called exact games. But this concept or analogous concept appeared in several other areas of mathematics. I came to them in the context on research on condition-dependent structure because supermodular set functions play an important role here, but these appear, well, submodular functions, which are nothing but mirror images of supermodular ones, occurs in optimization theory or matrix theory, if you like. And there is a theory of imprecise probabilities, 30 years old, where they introduce some other level of uncertainty to probability theory, consider sets of probability distributions in the one. And then there's a concept of coherent level probability, which corresponds to the concept of exact game, and two monotone capacity, which corresponds to the concept of supermodular game. But from the geometric point of view, both classes of set functions are nothing but special polyhedral cones in a highly dimensional space. The dimension of the space is exponential in number of players. What's called in game. I should mention that class of supermodular games, it's a subcone of the class of exact games. So we have like two cones and one is bigger. These cones are not pointed, so do not have extreme games, extreme rays, but if we consider in some certain subspace, they become pointed and we can talk about extreme rays, and then characterize the cones by the extreme rays. So, for various purposes, it would be good to characterize mathematically the extreme rays of these cones. Ideally, an enumeration procedure for generating all extreme rays would be suitable. Unfortunately, the number of these extreme rays seems to grow even super exponentially. Aim of this talk is not as ambitious, not to solve the Feynman problem, but only have a criterion to recognize the generators of extreme rays. So once you give me a supermodular function, we are able to show, to say that whether it's extreme or not. And these criteria are based on special min representations of the games. I will explain. This is by a finite list of vertices in a low dimensional space. The dimension of this space is just number of players. And basic such min representation is by means of vertices of certain ascribed polytope, which is called standardly in game theory the core. And actually these polyhedra occur in other contexts, and they are known in polyhedra geometry as so-called generalized permutahedra. And the criteria I will present provides both necessary and sufficient condition for the extremity. And they lead to solving an elementary system of linear questions, and there are solvers to do that, and therefore my colleague of mine, Vašek, implemented that in computer. I can give you a web platform and you can test it. So basic concepts. N is a finite set of elementary variables. They are correspond to players in game theory. This is my notation for the set of real vectors which are indexed by N. This is my notation to per power set. That is set of subsets of N. And a subset of the set of players is called coalition in cooperative game theory. And this is the notation for the corresponding vectors. These are actually nothing but set functions. Mathematically. And this is the definition of the concept of a core. And of course, a cooperative game, it's modeled in game theory by means set function with only a requirement as value for the empty set is zero. And core of the game is a special polytope, here defined by means of inequalities. And there is one linear equality constraint that the sum is one. For N, which is called grand coalition in game theory. And how to interpret this? And for every subset coalition, the sum over components in the coalition must be bigger than some value M of S. Well, that's a game about how to divide money, just to give you some interpretation. Assume that M is non-negative. So it's like we have n players and they want to divide this money. And each player should get this some amount. So components are like payoffs to the players in the game. So these elements of this space are like payoff vectors. And this these are vectors, payoffs. When you divide some amount of money, each coalition gets at least this number. That means this is sometimes expresses the strength of a coalition. So come to the Brussels, want to money, so players could be some different countries, yes, and that's it. Right. Yeah?
This set function satisfies some axiomatic?
I will tell some other conditions, that is general. By a game, they call any function like that.
Okay, yeah,
because they could be, this could be empty, this polytope.
But also for this interpretation you were like talking about,
non-negative.
You cannot indeed same function, because you have like the whole money that you will divide. I guess that for any set function is kind of difficult.
That's true. That's any set function. I will tell some conditions later. Yeah, but basically, they assume like automatically non-negative. Yeah, but this is just from geometric point of view, just shifting in the corresponding space. Okay, this is an example just to illustrate it. We have four players, and consider this set function. And so then the core, it's a polytope in four-dimensional space, but there is one equality restriction, linear. So actually it's a three-dimensional affine space. So and that's it. And so in that space, if you write the inequalities and compute the vertices, you find out that it's a simplex. And here it is written in some array form. Yeah. So that's the core. And now some definitions more detailed. Game is called balancing if it has non-empty core. And it's called exact if it's even some more additional condition hold. For every subset, There exists a vector, pale vector in the core, so that is tight for that lower bound. Yeah, so that's how it is defined. And set function is called supermodular if satisfies the supermodular inequality. And of course, you know that inverse inequality is called supermodularity. And we also have modular functions where the equality is. Supermodular games are called convex in game theory for some reason, because supermodularity somehow corresponds to convexity. And a well-known fact is that every supermodular game is exact. Yeah, so once you have these inequalities, then this holds. And both sets are polyhedral cones. It is evident for the supermodular cone, but it's not as evident for the exact one, but it's true. And these cones coincide for three players, but they differ in case of four players. So that's example. That's an example I have already mentioned. This game, it's exact. It has no empty core. And for every set, there exists tight vector. These are you can easily see that they must always be vertex of the core. So for coalition ABC, the vector is tight because if you sum these, you get 3, which is the value for the coalition. For coalition CD, value is 0, and you said the vector B is tight. Nevertheless, this is an example of non-supermodular game because supermodularity inequality is not valid. And as I told, both cones contain a linear space of modular functions, which has a dimension n at least. So therefore, neither of the cones is pointed. So in order to be able to talk about extreme rays, we have to cut it by some suitable space. And one of them is this one. We say that set function is lower standardized if values for the singletons and empty set is 0. Well, and then it's elementary that every set function can be uniquely decomposed in a lower part and a modular part. And it is exact and supermodular if and only if the same holds for the lower part. And this cone is already pointed, and so we can talk about the extreme rays. So here is the formal definition of extremity. We say that standardized function is extreme if it generates an extreme race of the respective cone. So we have extremity for supermodular cone and extremity in the exact cone. It can be different, yes. And you can extend this definition to a general function, supermodular or exact, just using the decomposition. It looks like this definition depends on the standardization. Actually, it's not. You can equivalently introduce extreme supermodular or exact game as a member of a relative interior of an atom of the face lattice of the cone. For every cone, we can also consider what is suitable representative. So one of possible normalization conditions that we fix the value for the grand coalition. Other, which I prefer, is that have integral representative, because all the cones are rational cones. Every extreme race is generated by integer valued function, and you can take integer valued function which has the values no common prime divisor. Okay, but here is an example how it looks in case of three players. In case of three players, it's eight-dimensional space, but you have here standardization, so these values are zeros, so that's in four-dimensional space. But then you cut it, we already know that it's pointed cone. That's cone for supernatural exact is the same. And cut it and normalize by one. Then you put it, you, in the, if you cut it by that affine, by the Hilbert plane, you got polytope. And the polytope has five extreme five vertices, just shown in this figure. So the number of extreme rays in case of three players, it's five. But it's not such nice. When you grow dimension, the number of extreme rays of both the cone of supernatural game and the cone of exact game grows. This is the result of some computation we made. It was supernatural cone, we made it in 2000. And this is the result of competition of Eric Quagebert. And well, in both cases, it looks like we are not able by common computer systems compute it for n equal to 5, 6. Okay, now I will make a review how this concept occur in other areas of mathematics. So I will with historical remark on the convex game. This was introduced by Shapley in the 1950s in this paper, where he also mentioned an open task of characterizing of extreme rays of the supernatural cone. Shapley was a kind of founder of this cooperative game theory. He was very famous. Actually, he got a Nobel Prize for application of results of game theory in economy. In economy, he got the Nobel Prize. So the concept of core was introduced in that paper, maybe, and it was interpreted as a set of acceptable payoff vectors. And he also introduced a kind of barycenter of this polytope, which is now called Shapley value in game theory. And this is considered as a, one of possible fair solutions to the game. Solution of the game is choice of a point in that polytope. And the concept of balance and exact game have been introduced later by researchers in game theory. Yes? Goal, well, no, literally goal was just to divide the money. No, Solution, it's maybe game how to divide money, at least my interpretation. Yeah, well, and now there is a analogous concept occurred in different areas of mathematics, and one of the branches is the theory of imprecise probabilities. This is a reference. And actually, you can really have kind of translation. That's basically the same concept, but data appear independently and with different terminology in different areas. So here, here is a kind of translation player in game theory corresponds to element of sample space in the theory of imprecise probabilities, and core corresponds to the cardinal set of probabilities. And the relation is explained here. If the game is non-negative and normalized by this, then elements of payoff vectors are actually probability discrete probability distributions. Yeah. And so that the core is nothing what is called cradle set of probabilities in context of, yes?
What is imprecise probability?
Imprecise. Well, they assume that you have probability distribution and you are not sure whether the actual values of probability of certain state it's exact, it's correct. So you want to have some possible relaxation. You say that it belongs to some interval. And it actually leads that instead of one probability distribution, you consider a set of probability distributions, typically a convex set of probability distributions. And that's called, they started to call imprecise. It's not one. Precise probability is called crisp probability in that context. Okay, so then the concept of balance games actually corresponds to concept called lower probability averaging sure loss. And exact game corresponds what is called coherent lower probabilities. and supermodular to what is called two monotone capacity or lower probability. There is clear relation, which I explained here. Maybe I should make, is there a chalk here somewhere? No, here, okay. It's like the relation of this I have already mentioned. It's like you have the here some cone, you cut it, yes, and you get the polytope. And the relation, mathematical relation of these two concepts is that in an imprecise probability they are interested in the polytope, while in game theory in that cone. Yes? There are set of additive probabilities. Yeah, but either you can consider lower bound and upper bound. They are either described by lower bounds or upper bounds. If they are described by upper bounds, they are not additive, they are super modular.
What do you call it? I think if you take like again M, you normalize, so that should be a coherent lower probability, but that's not necessarily an additive function.
No. That's everything is discrete here.
So a coherent lower probability does not satisfy any additive.
Formally, the lower probability, they could talk about lower probability, yes, and that's basically the same like supermodular exact game with additional requirement M equals to 1. If you get their definition, yes. Coherent lower infinite is a polytope. Yeah? Set of coherent. Coherent. No.
What I'm saying is this. The modular games are additive set functions. So,
yeah.
I'm familiarized with the normal use of probability that is an additive function. So, I would expect modular games in the normalized version to correspond to probabilities, but I don't know what are these.
Okay, in imprecise, the correspondence is here. The elements of what is players in game theory, they correspond to element of the sample space. They have like finite sample space, finite probabilities, yeah? And the cradle set of probabilities is what it's a set of probability distributions. And that cradle set of probabilities is described by lower probabilities, lower bounds. Yeah? And these actually are set functions. So they are, and up to constant, they are the same like in game theory. Yeah? That's a relation. And by the way, the standardization corresponds to excluding, say, crisp probabilities, that's what it's saying. So, because there is naturally basically the same mathematical concepts in both areas but called differently, there is no wonder there was analogous effort explained independently in both areas. And one of them was to compute the extreme arrays in game theory or extreme vectors in imprecise probabilities. So, in imprecise probabilities, being motivated by the question raised by Maas, Quageber and Kuhmann became interested in the extreme lower probabilities. They are like the extreme vertices of that set of, they call it cradle set. Yeah. And they computed it for a small number of variables. And I have shown it in the picture earlier. Why I'm mentioning this? Because it is useful. Somehow be aware of results achieved in other areas and be aware of correspondence. Because you can avoid reproving the things. For example, Waldner, in the context of imprecise probabilities, confirmed some conjecture of Weichselberger, one of founders of this imprecise probability, that the cradle set of probabilities has at most n factorial vertices, where n is the number of elements of the sample space. But actually the same result in the context of game theory was achieved 4 years ago by Deck and Kupers. Yeah. That's just to show. Where else one can meet supernodal functions? They occurred in the context of condition independent structures. That's my topic, but I will skip it. Mirror images of supernodal functions, which are submodal functions, have been widely studied in optimization and matroid theory. A relevant concept is that of rank function of a matroid. Polymatroid is a submodal function. And the relation of to optimization matroid goes through polyhedral geometry. More specifically, the class of polytopes, which are cores of these supermodal games, is appeared in mathematics at least twice, once already in the 1970s as the class of polymatroids, introduced by Edmonds, and that word polymatroid later started to be used not for the name polytope but the respective submodal function. And that also appeared quite recently in polyhedral geometry, and they are called generalized permutahedra. These have been introduced by Postnikov's co-authors. These are polytopes which can be obtained from normal permutahedron by some transformation which keeps parallelism of edges. Maybe I should tell what permutahedron is. It's simply if you have n and you say equal 1, 2, 3, you can take all the permutation. Consider it as vectors in a real vector space, take convex hull. So in case of 3, it's hexagon, etc. So it's very nice regular polytope. And the relation of generalized permutation to the geometry of condition independence was pinpointed by Jason Morton in his thesis. Here I explain the duality of supermodal and submodal functions through the cone. If consider a polytope, which is core of supermodal game, that is generalized permutahedron, or and then the values of the function can be found on basis of that polytope as a lower bounds. Yeah, but if you go the tight lower bound something, and if you take the tight upper bounds, you got the dual submodal game, which is related to the submodal game. So upper and lower bounds are related by this. So in context of imprecise probabilities, they also call it lower probability and upper probability. One is submodular, the other is supermodular. And the special example is, so then there is nothing what is called also base polytope of a supermodular game in combinatorial optimization. And also another name, matroid polytope, if R is the rank function of a matroid. Okay. The criterion I'm going to present is based on special min representation of a game, say, by additive functions. So basically, submodal function can be written as a setwise minimum of finitely many additive functions. Every additive function is described by a vector. So a min representation is a finite set of vectors such that values for the set, it's a minimum of all the corresponding additive functions. And we have a special concept, feasible. Min representation is a min representation consisting of elements of the core. That means every vector in the main representation has the same sun. Then some combinatorial concept is useful in this context. And this is, I call it tightness class of the sets. Once we have a vector in a main representation, you can assign to it a collection of sets at which the vector is tight. Yes, and the tightness structure of a main representation is the collection of these tightness classes. Now you see it's already fully combinatorial concept. Just example to illustrate it, again the same game, the same core, and what I claim that vertices of the core actually give a mini representation of the game, that you can, from them, from this list, you can read off the values of the game. You need not 2 over n values, you only can keep in your memory of your computer this. For example, for coalition AB, you make a minimization over the rows of the sum 2, 4, 2, 2. Minimum is 2, which is the value for AB. Or you have coalition CD and minimize 2, 0, 2, 2. Minimum is 0, and it's a value for D. And here I illustrate the concept of a tightness class for the vector alpha, which is a set of all vectors at which this vector is tight. So it's tight for empty set, for then AB, AC, but not for, say, CD. Okay. It could be several main representation. Okay, let me skip something. Yeah, I skipped this. Point is that game is exact if and only if it emits a feasible main representation. And every exact game has a standard main representation, which are vertices of the core. And this has a special property that for each vector in the in that main representation is enough big tightness class. Because if you take indicators of that sets, then they generate linearly whole space. Yeah, and this is actually characterization of extremality. In the that means these are characterized vertices of the core. But they could be other main representation than just this standard one. Okay. But the standard one is exceptional among them in which in certain sense. And this is says in which sense. You can, if you have fixed game, you can consider different standardization, different main representation, and you can compare them. And there is some relation between them. If R and L are two main representations, they have corresponding tightness structure, and we say that the tightness structure for R refines the tightness structure for L if every tightness set from R is a subclass of tightness set in Y. Well, and it's quasi-ordering, so you can introduce equivalence relation of being equally fine, yes, and within each equivalence class of you can find uniquely determined pruned tightness structure where you basically remove vectors which do not have maximal tightness classes. And the result is then easy that actually that's finite lattice, and the coarsest tightness structure is that which corresponds to the standard main representation. And there is some finest tightness structure, minimum in its, and this can be constructed from the standard main representation, but the technical details are omitted. Remark is that coarsest tightness structure actually corresponds to the concept of coarse structure, combinatorial concept, which was introduced in context of game theory. Okay. I will mention two criteria. The first one is about the extremity of supermodal gain, which has already been published, and that's based on causes type of structure. On the other hand, I have also recent criterion for extremity in exergoem, but which is based on finest tightening structure, so just the difference. The criteria are analogous. In both cases, they lead to solving some elementary system of linear questions, which is implementable on the computer. Here I have a remark that extremity in both cones could be different concept. So situation is like this. Say, assume this is This is a supermodular cone, and then exact cone looks like this. But really, there is some some extreme ray in the which is extreme in the supermodular cone, but which is not, say, extreme in the supermodular in the exact game. Yeah, situation like this. Okay, I will make a picture in a plane like this. If you cut it already, so there is some extreme point in the supermodular case, which is not extreme point in the exact domain. Yeah. Okay, so to present it, the criterion, we take the main representation and arrange it in a rectangular form. That means each row corresponds to the vector and each column corresponds to a player. So actually the tightness classes can be also encoded that then corresponds to rows and can be read off the array. Now, every feasible representation defines a system of linear constraints for the entries. And this system of linear constraints actually is valid for the original linear representation. And the equation system basically depends only on tightness classes. Here I describe the system. There are like two conditions, two simple conditions. One condition says that basically you have y whenever x is zero, yes? The other says that for every set which is both in tightness classes for rho tau and rho sigma, the sum for this set in those rows is the same. That's actually valid for the original vector. And so then we can say that dimension of a tightness structure is dimension of the space of solutions of to the system. And the result is that the game is extreme in supermodular game if and only if the dimension of the causes tightness structure is one. And here I have a little remark for the correspondence. This corresponds to indecomposability of the polytope with respect to Minkowski sum. And actually one can show that the extremity of the supermodular game corresponds to indecomposability of that corresponding core or generalized permutahedron. So implicitly we got some criterion to recognize indecomposability. Our criterion is simpler than Meyer's original criterion. But Meyer's original criteria is in terms of phases and work for general polytope, why this is limited to generalized permutahedra. Here I illustrate the system. So consider, for example, three players and this game, value for singletons is zero. Then the core, it's a triangle. This, it's written here is array form. You can read of the tightness classes here. And this is the system of linear equations. You basically assume that whenever x is zero, then y is zero. And then if you have a set, say, SAB, which is in row P and sigma, then the sum must be the same for P and sigma. So if you take this equality, you see that these two, and take this in consideration, you see that this is the same. Analogously for AC, this is in these two, P and tau. So this leads that these two things must be the same, and the third one is that these two must be the same. That's a question. And there is last equation corresponding to N, which is in all these threads. It leads to this equation, and that means everything must be constant. Everything non-zeros must be the same. There's another example if it doesn't work, that the dimension could be more than one. And I have also just a remark on the case of exact games. The extremity in this case is based on same linear system equations, but the system is ascribed to finite state structure. And then some modification is needed because there exists some additional unwanted solutions to that system, which cannot occur in the case of closest finite structure. The point is that if the closest, well, the finest manifestation can contain a vector which is in the core but not its vertex, and therefore it has smaller tightening structure because these vectors do not generate whole Rn. And this basically means that this is an example of an additional solution of that system in this case, but I will skip that. And the result is that for exact games is, okay, I have not defined reduced dimension, or have I? Yeah, I have not defined. This is a space of unwanted, so dimension of the space of unwanted solution. So we define a reduced dimension of the tightness structure as a diff in such a way that the dimension of the system minus this dimension of unwanted solutions. And then the result is that games extreme if and only if the reduced dimension of the finest tightness structure is one. The finest mean representation is not unique, but the equation system is. Okay, and if you are interested in the result of work of my colleague Vašek, you can go to these web platforms and test our software. Thank you for attention.